Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It is quite a cold morning today, but regardless, we'll still be glad in the day, for this is the day that the Lord has made. So for those of you joining us from online, karibuni sana, and we hope you'll have just as much fun in the presence of the Lord. So at this time, I'd ask you all to stand, please, as we worship the Lord together. Amen.
By his nail pierced.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God again. Isn't it been wonderful? I would like you to turn to your neighbor because we're about to dance today. Turn to your neighbor and tell him that I am going to dance for a God that does the impossible. He's doing the impossible for me now. And he's going to do the impossible for me in the future. Hallelujah! Let me see you clap your hands. Come on. Come on, let's go. 1, 2, 3, 4. And buzz. Let's go. One more time. 1, 2. Buzz. Let me see this side. Let's see this side go. 1, 2. And buzz. This side, this side, this side. Turn there. 1, 2. And buzz. Online, online, online. 1, 2. And buzz. Let's go again. 1, 2. Shangwe na vigele gele kwa Yesu. Hakuna Mungu kama wewe Bwana. Hakuna Mungu kama wewe Bwana. Hakuna Mungu kama wewe Yesu. Hakuna Mungu kama wewe.
Mozart.
Ametenda majabu aye,
sifu bwana
aye, sifu bwana
ametenda majabu aye,
sifu bwana
aye.
Shangwe na vigele gele na vigele gele kwa Bwana Yesu.
Shangwe na vigele gele na vigele gele kwa Bwana Yesu.
Shangwe na vigele gele na vigele gele kwa Bwana Yesu.
Shangwe na vigele gele na vigele gele kwa Bwana Yesu.
Shangwe na vigele gele na vigele gele kwa Bwana Yesu.
In the presence of the Lord. If we are, let me just hear a shout one more time for Jehovah Jireh. Thank you so much. We worship you, Lord. And I want to turn us to a scripture that really caught my eye. That when I was singing this song, it really took me aback. But not in a bad way, of course. It refers to Isaiah 40, towards the end of the chapter, which says, "He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." And so for those who are going through it's troubling times, whether it's losing a job, whether it's losing a family member, just know the Lord will give you strength. I know it's a difficult time right now for you guys. Those who are even having questions about their lives, I do know that the Lord will give you strength. The Lord will restore you and become like an eagle. The Lord will restore you like the youth, and he'll give you strength to be able to fly away and soar above any challenge. Just put your hope in the Lord. Let's hear a voice for him and praise him.
Oh yes, Jesus, we praise you. Lord, we praise you, holy name. Lord, you restore, you restore, you restore.
Just raise up your voice to the Lord. Raise your voice up to the Lord, for he will hear you. For Jesus, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna.
One more time, church. Let's sing.
Hosanna. Jesus died and rose again. Hey!
You are the God that restores. You are the God that reigns forevermore. Mighty God, lift up your voice unto the Lord Jehovah. Lift up your voice unto him, for he is hearing your cries. He is hearing your cries and he is saying, I will restore your energy. I will do the impossible in the time that you don't think it's possible. I will do what is impossible in Jesus' name. That's what he's saying to you. Call out his name, call out his name, call out his name. Oh, he restores, he restores, he restores. Mighty Jesus, you restore every ounce of my being. Mighty Jesus, we've come here to worship you. Oh God, we worship you. Lord, we worship you.
Church, how about you just open up your mouth just for a minute and tell God thank you. That's what we are saying, that we are coming to the altar. We have come to the altar, to Mount Zion, to the King of Kings, to the Lord of Lords. And Lord Jesus, we bless you and we thank you for your goodness of our lives. And as we have sung, Lord, that's the declaration from our hearts, that, Lord, you're a good God, and therefore we come to the altar. We are bowing down before the King of Kings. We are bowing down before the Lord of Lords. We have come to the altar as who are laden, and we want to take upon your yoke, which is lighter. We're coming before you at the altar with our heavy hearts regarding the situations we see around us. We're coming to the altar so that we can sing hallelujah, knowing that, God, you're dealing. We're coming to you with songs of praise because of the good God you have been to our lives. Some of us are really, really grateful for how far you have brought us. We have songs of praise, Lord. Therefore, we are coming to the altar to bring this praise to you. And we're coming to the altar even when we don't know what to say. We have no words to verbalize how we feel. We're just coming to the altar because it has to come and we'll find rest for our weary souls. So we come to the altar. Jesus, we come to the altar. How about we just sing that one more time? We come into the altar as our declaration.
Christ is risen.
Nairobi Chapel, put your hands for Jesus. One more time for Jesus. One more time for Jesus. Karibuni sana. Please give a hand to the worship team as they take their seats. That was wonderful.
Amen and amen and amen. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Praise Jesus. It is good to be here. It is good to see you all. First, before anything else, I think there's a strange phenomenon in front of you. And for that reason, I don't know if the band can help us cue us on what's going on so that we can all be at ease and at home. We're going to have an amazing service today, all right? It's going to be a wonderful time. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Nduati Murigi. I'm married to one wife, Wanjiro Nduati. I don't know if she's somewhere here. She's probably with the kids. We both serve as pastors here at Nairobi Chapel, Lavington. It's always a pleasure to see you all. And I have this opportunity to welcome you today to today's service. And with me is a friend. And a wonderful man that you should all know. And so I'll allow him to introduce himself to us.
Good morning, Nairobi Chapel. Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
Geshohi Waweru is my good name, and I am privileged and honored to be service hosting with Pastor Nduati. I am also married to one wife, very, very beautiful Njeri. Just say hi. No, put your hand. They need to see, you know. All right. Thank you so much. And karibuni sana to those of us who are joining us online all the way from United States of Rongai, United States of Kino, United States of Ushago, and everyone who is joining us online. Karibuni sana.
Yes. We welcome you all. I think it was very important for us to mention that we are married. Today might
Hallelujah.
Be a day of tempting for many. I'm joking.
But you don't say.
No. But that's something about us. I hope you have been well, Gishohi.
I've had a good week. Bado tunapambana. If you know, you know.
Yes, it's been a wonderful time. I am good as well. I am very grateful to God this morning. I have an advocate on earth and an advocate in heaven.
Hallelujah.
And that's
Hallelujah.
Wonderful. But I just wanted to let you know, Gishohi is a wonderful lawyer, advocate. And he does this to serve people, but ultimately to serve Jesus as well. And it's beautiful to see you serve God here and out there.
Amen. That's you know, when you're affirmed in your presence, it feels some type of way, especially coming from a brother. But I love you, bro. Thank you so much for the kind words. Our parents in the church are wondering why the worship team is so happy. So there happens to be a situation going around the country, and luckily I'm on their speed dial. So Tuesday, hapa mbele, tuko sawa. Amen. Thank you. And that being said, there are those of us who are worshiping here for the very first time, or even if it's not your first time, those of you who have been away and have been lured back to the congregation, can I see by a show of hands if you're here for the first time? Thank you, thank you.
Please keep your hand up. We have a hand there.
Yes, I love it. I love it. Please keep on your hand up.
Yeah.
Thank you so very, very much. Karibuni sana. Nairobi Chapel, what do we say to them? Karibuni sana. And as you were raising up your hand, a card was put onto your hand. And what we want to ask you, would you just take a few minutes and just fill in your details? And I know, you know, being a lawyer, we are mindful of your data. We are not going to use it for any other purpose than the lawful purpose that we are taking it. And what we want to do is that we want to get to know you better, to know how to serve you better, to connect with you, and to even know how Nairobi Chapel Lavington can be a blessing to you, Pastor Ndwati.
Yeah, that's true. And allow us, please, the opportunity to get to know you even more. And so what we want to do is, after the service, please give us a few minutes. We have an area designated for you called our Karibu Lounge. It is on our right, and it's basically the living room area in the house that's on our right. Please make your way there. I'll urge the wenyejis, if you are seated next to a visitor, please guide them to that place so that we can host them. It's an opportunity to know you, but even for you to know us. And so would you have any questions? Would you have any inquiries? Would you even have a prayer request? It would be a wonderful opportunity to even pray with you. Our prayer pastors will be there, and our hospitality team will be there. One more time, please, let's appreciate all our first-time visitors. Karibuni, karibuni, sana, sana, sana.
Very well. And for the locals, we have not yet forgotten you. As usual, every Sunday after service, there is... Hallelujah. One more time, there is... So please, allow that you don't live like a bullet. Unafanya bullet inatokanga very fast, eh? Don't live like a bullet. Stay around, hang out for us with Chai Mandazi. Let's get to know how your week was. Let's get to know one another, how we're doing, and how we can also keep praying with one another.
Yes. Stay put. Be aware that because of what has been happening, our advocate here, all his metaphors will be Mandamano related. So if you hear, don't, you know... but yeah, stick around. Don't go away too fast. Let's get that opportunity to connect. Something as wonderful has been happening here at Nairobi Chapel, Lavington, and today is a day of celebration. There is something wonderful that has been happening for the past 3 months. There is a group in the midst of our congregation that has been going through a wonderful program that is called Zindua. How many people have heard of Zindua? I can see a couple of hands. So we'll hear a little bit about it today. I know Gishoi got the chance to do it, the previous cohort. Maybe you could tell us what Zindua is.
Zindua is actually Swahili for takeoff. I have wanted to use this for a while. For those of us who are frequent flyers, you probably have heard, hello guys, this is your captain, and da da da. Yes, Zindua is Swahili for takeoff. And what this then looks like is you get a chance to do life with a group of people in a community setting of 10, 15 people, and you go through the life seasons of life, and you have a chance to reflect upon what has been and what will be. And definitely you want to be part of the Zindua experience.
Yes, it's such a wonderful transformational program. And we are here to celebrate that not just one, not just two, not just 10, not just 50, but 100 people are graduating this service.
I mean, you can do better than that. 100 people.
I'll actually invite them to stand. If you notice, there's a color that's dominating in our midst, the color orange. I'll invite them to stand. That is their color as they celebrate.
If you're among the 100 people graduating today, show them some
love. Let's celebrate them.
Show them some love. Very well, very well, very well.
So good.
Asante. Yeah. And there's a photo of them there.
Yeah.
Don't they look amazing? One more time, let's appreciate them, church.
Yeah. Thank you. I'll invite them to have their seats. So evidently, because of the numbers, they couldn't all be here, but I hope you've been able to see them. Well, we have three of them who actually want to share a testimony on what Zindua has done for them. And so we'll have a video playing on the screen, but as it plays, I'd like to invite Immaculate, Nathan, and Paris to come on to share their testimony.
Enjoy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Winnie from the Alpha Zindua group, and I'm here to share my testimony. So when I heard this announcement about Zindua, it really put something in my heart. And for a long time, I've been searching for meaning, searching for purpose, trying to figure out my life now that I'm in my 30s, because I felt like maybe in my 20s and 30s, I've not maybe made the best of decisions, and also struggling with a few things here and there. So when I had this announcement, I thought, why not join Zindua? Maybe I might get certain answers. And mainly listening to people who are older than me or my peers who've done things differently, it would help me shift my way of doing things. So when I joined Zindua, I was feeling lost, not sure if God will redeem me, not sure whether God will get me out of the rut I thought I'm stuck in. And indeed, it's been uplifting. The last couple of weeks doing Zindua have really been uplifting. And part of the things I've learned in Zindua is that I might have felt like a failure before. I might have felt like I'm doomed. But God just reminded me during Zindua that He has a hope and a future for me. He also just reminded me that He's about to change the tune of my song, that He's just about to change the script of the story I was telling myself. And that has been very comforting. So one of the takeaways has been, as much as I didn't launch well in my 20s, due to certain circumstances, it's just been a reminder that now that I'm in my 30s, it's never too late to start afresh. And based on the word that was shared and the testimonies that were shared and the teachings that we had, I got to learn that it's never too late, and especially when it comes to finances. As much as maybe I might not have made the best of decisions, and mainly in my 30s, I would say it's because of a failed marriage and being a single mother, I've found myself struggling a bit with finances. But Zindua has just taught me to shift my thinking. And it's taught me certain things that I need to do so that I can change that story. And also when it comes to parenting, it took me back to a very reflective point that I sought myself and thought about how I'd been raised, and to change the narrative as I nurture my daughter as well. And I think right now I'm more than ready, and I'm certain that I'll launch well in my 50s. And I'd encourage anyone else who's not done Zindua, I'd encourage them to enroll for the next cohort, because for sure it's life-changing. Thank you all.
Let's appreciate them even as they come to share.
So good morning, church. It's really a privilege to be standing before you this morning. Before I share my testimony and my story, since I got the opportunity to stand before all of you, I first want to say a very sincere thank you to all of you for standing with my family when we lost Ben in April. Many of you know my son died on April 22nd, and I have felt, of course, together with my family, we have felt your love, your support. For those of you who visited at home, who sent us message, supported us materially, I have had this opportunity to stand here and say thank you, because I wasn't able to reach all of you at the same time. This felt like a good time to say asanteni sana, and may God refresh you as you refreshed us. Continue to pray for our family as we continue to pray for one another. Now to my testimony about Zindua. When I first heard of Zindua, not this year, the other year, and when Anzaya talked about it, I got a sudden panic attack, literally. And I remember asking a question in church, and I said, my goodness, so for us who have already done everything the opposite, what happens to us? And I remember he answered and said, it's not all lost, and there's a lot to learn as we do Zindua. So I quickly signed up, but because of certain circumstances, I wasn't able to join that cohort. But this year, I purposed and I told God to give me the grace to be able to do it. And so I want to start also by saying thank you, Anzaya and Dr. Mbithe, for allowing God to use you in this generation for kingdom impact. Because the study truly gives you an opportunity, or rather has given me an opportunity for reflection. And you've heard the speaker before me say the same thing. And so for that, may God reward you and continue to bless you. I want to say thank you also to my very passionate leader, Kathleen. You led us and steered us with passion and commitment and very authentic and being vulnerable and giving us your own journey of story. When I was signing up, I wanted to be with people who are in my age space, so that, you know, I thought we'll have common issues to deal with, and it would be easier to deal with people who are like me, and mostly I thought women. But God did something very interesting. He put me in a group that had some men, and I'm very grateful for that, because we got to see things from the other side. We had very young women who I just want to thank God for. And maybe you can stand up, we clap for you, because you have been our reverse mentors. And you may not know it, but I want to say on behalf of the others that we are super, super grateful that you found yourselves in our group, because we have learned a lot by seeing things through your lens of the younger people. So thank you very much for that. So my personal testimony goes this way. I lost my father very early. I was 20. And because of that and many other things, I didn't launch properly. And therefore, I made several mistakes. And some of them I shared in our group that they looked catastrophic. But one thing that remained constant, and I know today as a matter of fact, is that God's hand was literally upon me, because despite those catastrophic mistakes, somehow He helped me to navigate life. And there are certain things through Zindua I learned that I was actually doing right, and yet I was guessing. And that should tell you that God's hand was literally upon me, and for that I'm forever grateful. I also got an opportunity to reflect and got into deep reflection on certain things that I have definitely not been doing right. And going back into the place of humility and asking God to help me, to give me the grace to turn things around so that I'm a better human being. And so because of Zindua, I have been affirmed, I have been rebuked, I have had an opportunity to learn to come to a place of humility and ask God for forgiveness and to guide me and hold my hand and help me to be a better person. And most importantly, I have made lifelong friendships of women who are slightly older, women who are younger, and of course some who are, and men also, there are men in our group, two men. I don't know if they are here and we can acknowledge them. Kiama, I see you. Thank you for your contribution into the group. I think Bobby wasn't able to come. So I just want to thank God for that. And finally, I hope that everything that I learned, the transformation will be something that I live in my everyday life, in my relationships with my significant relationships with the people around me, at my place of work, at my place of worship, that it will really be seen. And I would encourage anyone who has not done Zindua to truly consider to make the time to do it, because it's life transformational. Thank you very much.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Morning.
Good morning, church. First of all, Zion and Duarte Nasut. The Lord is doing in your life. He who finds a wife truly. No jobs. My name is Nathan Rono. I am part of Group 3, and we call ourselves Shamiri. And yeah, ask your neighbor what Shamiri means. It's a beautiful name. I'm born again, and I wanted to say I'm excited to be standing here, but I feel like I am scared, 90%, but we'll get through this. Last week during Testimony Sunday, someone stood here and said that they prayed while they were young, that when they get to 60, they don't want to have any regrets. And they were sharing and thanking God that they truly didn't have regrets for their past 30 years. And so I was asking myself this week, even thinking about Zindua, how do I get to 60 without regrets in my life? It's a big question, because kuna milima na mabonde. And so throwback to a few months ago, I was passing by church, you know, saying hi to my friends, Shiro and Duarte. And I think Pastor Anzaya was preaching. There was a sermon series. And after the service, I remember asking Kinandwati, oh, this sermon was very practical. They're like, oh, by the way, he's preaching for the entire month. So would you want to stay? So I stayed for the entire month. And fast forward, Zindua started and I joined. At the point when I was joining Zindua, there's so many things happening in my life. You know, in the busyness of life, when you call me, my friends would say that I'm like the busiest person in this Nairobi. Nathan, what are you doing? I'm busy, you know. Some of us are workaholics. We like to call ourselves workaholics. And sometimes we say, I love my job, or I'm busy doing my job, as if it's a good thing, right? And so some of these things, they spiral down. And some days you find yourself, you find it easier to sit in the house rather than to come to church. And so for me, at that point in my life, I needed a lot of clarity. And I needed to know what it means to live a whole life. And I think a few months, I was sharing with my group that, oh, by the way, in the next few months, I'll be turning 30. And so this week, I actually turned 30. And for the people who are in their 30s already, is this how it feels to be old? I'm kidding. I'm only a few days old. Lakini mneza niambia pali kaluma inauzo wa nianze kujipanga. You don't have no understanding what Solomon Kubwa said, you know. Nilikuwa kijana, sasa mimi mzee. Anyway, very quickly, let me tell you what I've learned with Zindua. With Zindua, I have learned that I may now make very difficult and uncomfortable decisions. I think as young people, it's easy for us to... Oh, I said young, sorry. It's easy to look and make decisions that are like, you know, the impact, you think the impact is like 2 years, you know. But then some of these decisions with Zindua, we've learned, have an impact. I have learned that I must be intentional in thinking about a whole life, thinking about my faith, thinking about family, thinking about work, my contribution to the society. Tuesday, tupatane pale, contribution to society. Thinking about my wealth, thinking about my health also, right? And so just thinking about a whole life and not just one part of your life. I know that man plans, but the Lord, with Zindu, I've learned that man plans, but the Lord sustains. And so as I think about my next 3 decades or 4 decades or 5 decades, I do so in faith, praying that Christ will surely bring all these things together in completion. One of the famous quotes I tell my friends sometimes is that life, you know, my friend, life is not a straight line. You know, there'll be ups, you know, kuna kona, na kuna milima, na kuna mabonde. with Zindua, I have learned that windows do close. Opportunities do come and go, right? Clearly, 5 years ago I was 25, now I'm 30. There are things I can't apply for. You know, some of those things, some of these opportunities that come maybe for masters abroad or somewhere, they normally say, you know, if you're 28 and below. And so some of those opportunities, they have gone. And that's the reality of life, that Zindua has opened our eyes and says, hey, look, there are windows of life. That's a reality. But these windows, they do close. So are you aware that these windows are actually closing down on you? And so choices have consequences. That's what I have learned, that the decision I make now, consequences will be visible later in life. I have learned to look up to Christ to guide me as I transition through the stages of health, wealth, contribution to society, character, marriage. Speaking of marriage, the pressure is getting worse. Yeah? sorry, guys. Does the pressure increase? Or you know, I went to see my parents this week, you know, and anytime wakikufungulia mlango, like, oh, welcome, karibu sana. Hakuna mugeni. You know, and I was like, you know, they're indirectly saying, you know, does the pressure increase or decrease? Anyway, in conclusion, my takeaway from Zindua is also that I have learned that God is he who matters in my story. There's a quote in the guide that says, with God's help, Joseph excelled in his job. One of my virtues that I say everywhere, including interviews, if you ever call me for an interview, I'm a communications professional. Anyway, one of the virtues I carry a lot is excellence. But then I saw this quote that said, with God's help, Joseph actually excelled in his life. And so I need God's help to actually excel in all these areas of my life. I pray that I build my life upon God, upon the solid rock, and not on sand that is quickly swept away. While all these dreams I write about my 60s are good, I pray that I'll not lose sight of who's the superhero in this story. And one of my prayers after Zindua is that also I should be aware that these windows are closing, and one of the windows that is closing is that Christ will surely come back again. And when he comes, I pray that he will find me standing strong in my faith as I prepare for his return. I pray that the Lord strengthens me to do all these things in my life, in my health, in my wealth, in my community, even in my job and in my career, till the day he returns and calls me home. Let me just share one of the prayers that I pray as when we finish up writing our visions with our group. Is that I pray, I sing this to him sometimes. One of them is, guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Help me with, or hold me with thy powerful hand. You can read the other words. But also another hymn that I pray, and hopefully that we pray with our group, is that, hey, this one's, I don't have the words, but I have them somewhere here. Let's see. Oh yeah, be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save thou art. Thou, my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom and my true word, I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord, thy great Father, and I, thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling and I with thee one. Riches I heed not. Yes, we talk about wealth a lot in Zindu also. But riches I heed not, nor vain empty praise. Thou my inheritance now and always, thou and thou only first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art. You can read the words of the hymn later. But Zindua has basically told me how to live a whole life. And thank you so much, Pastor Nzaya, for this wonderful guide, and Dr. Mbide. And also thank you to Pastor Mike. And I would especially want to thank Shamiri Group for being vulnerable in their stories and for walking this journey together. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I'd like just to, it would be good to pray for these people, a prayer of blessing and a prayer of commissioning. What has been shared here is representative of all the stories that are being transformed, and God is doing a work in and through them. And so I'll invite the people that you've been mentioned who are behind this wonderful program and curriculum. I'll invite Anzaya and the wife Mbithe to just come and just make a prayer. I'll invite those who are graduating today to just stand so that we can pray for you.
Thank you very much for this opportunity, and so wonderful to see you all and the testimonies that we have heard, and I'm sure the Lord has worked in each one of our lives. We started with a challenge at the beginning of April when we asked, what will you buy with your life? And we pray that God has been working in your life and you've been making commitments so that as life goes by, you'll be able to put things before him that he will be happy about. And we pray that the key verses that came up every time you finished a chapter, which was David's story, and God said about him in Acts, I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. That, you know what God wants you to do going forward, and that you have gotten a greater heart for God. And then the result would be now, when David, God's servant, had finished his life, he served his purpose in his own generation. That by doing this, God would actualize his purpose, his dream, through your life. And this would be said of each one of you and each one of us. And not only at the end, but being able, for God to be able to say that month after month about us. So I'll ask Mbithe, Dr. Mbithe, to pray for all of us. Thank you.
Lord, this morning we are humble to stand before you, and we are thankful for life. We are thankful that you died for each one of us in this congregation today, us and our loved ones. Lord, we are thankful for the opportunity to spend 3 months and even continue to be in your word and to learn from you. And Lord, we know that what counts in our lives is being ready to meet you. So for these individuals, each of them standing 100 and the ones who could not join today, we want to commit each of them before you. We want to thank you for their lives. We want to thank you for the people who have stood there with them during this time. We want to thank you and commit their future before you. And Lord, we want to trust that each of them, like David, will serve their generation, your purpose in their generation, all their lives. Lord, you know their needs. Meet them at their point of needs. Through the mountains and the valleys, may they be encouraged to know that you are with them. You will never leave them nor forsake them. We pray for them. We pray for the support systems. We pray for their faith, that they will be encouraged to the end. And Lord, you find them faithful servants, and they will serve well to the end. We pray that they will bear fruit to old age. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Can give them a hand as they sit.
Yeah. I know helping in the background for all these people, there were coaches, facilitators, counselors, people helping in the administration. We'd like to celebrate you as well. If you're there and you are part of this team, either a coach, a facilitator, counselor, admin, could you just stand so that we celebrate you as well? Because these have graduated because you gave of yourselves as well. Thank you so much. Asanteni, asanteni, asanteni.
Right, something else has been happening for the last 2 months, and as a church, we are on the
move.
Okay. One more time. Let me try. So something else has been happening by the sidelines. And as a church, we are on the
move.
Thank you so very much. And we have been on the move for a while. And we'd like to bring to you how far we have come with this, Pastor Nduati.
Yes, we promise just to keep us updated on what's going on. So we continue to thank you for your generosity. We'll have a graph showing us where we are at. But at the moment, people have been giving. In terms of cash in hand, we thank you. We are now at the 350,000 mark. Yes, we should appreciate. And the pledges are 1.4 million to be redeemed between now and December. We should appreciate ourselves even more. So even the report I'm giving as it stands now is not the actual figure. I just know by the time we got this report and to now, there are people who have committed to pledge, there are people who have given, and we don't have that figure there. But just that's to celebrate us and to invite us as well. Let's keep rallying towards this cause that God has set us on, that God has given us this. And in this, in a collective effort, we can manage to deal with the deficit. So you can see there's a huge area in orange that amounts to roughly 13 million. The goal is to punguza the orange and to ongeza the green. And so we invite you so that we can move that wheel accordingly, and ultimately we can thank God for what he's doing through us and in us.
Very well, and we continue to give, and even during offertory, we'll have an opportunity to give. And what you will do then as you're giving is that you will indicate the account, the move. Also, as a fundraising team and as a church, we have thought about ways in which we can help each other, even as we navigate through this move. And one of the things that has come up in the recent past is that as a church, we have amongst ourselves professionals, guys who can paint, guys who can do plumbing, lawyers like myself, architects, DJs. And what we are doing then as a church is we are asking you, would you consider, in line with the theme and the scriptures we read in May for talent and treasure, would you consider giving your treasure, whereby as a church we will collate the information of the professionals we have in the team, and then we will find amongst ourselves who has got work that they could be given unto them. Case in point, I'm a lawyer. You could bring me, when you're selling your 15 million USD shamba, you give it to me, I can transact on your behalf, and then I have a percentage out of the work I get from the church that I will commit towards the move. So what you're going to do, is that amazing? Thank you. So allow us to meet a need in the congregation as we meet the need of the church. So if you want to be part of that, please see Pastor Mike on the move desk as we are coming to the end of the service and sign up for that.
Yeah, so we actually have a specific desk. If you can look to where I'm pointing, there's a desk there. Pastor Mike is there, yellow, orangish draping. There is all the information that you would need. So we also have pledge cards. I'm being distracted by the people who've laughed at me because I've said yellow or whichever color. But right there are pledge cards. If you want to redeem your pledge, you took a card, you want to give it back, or you want to get a card as well, that's a place where you can get all the information, make any inquiries. So after the service, we welcome you to make your way there. We are about to invite the preacher of the word today. We are kicking off a new sermon series that's called Mission Him Possible. Tell your neighbor, Mission Him Possible.
Mission Him Possible.
And I tell you, we are going to be in for a ride. It's a wonderful, wonderful series of messages that are being brought to us by Pastor Simon Mbevi. So you can tell this is derived from the action film franchise Mission Impossible. How many people are fans of like action movies? Let me just show us a clip that will cue us in on what this looks like.
You gotta get down here now.
For the people who've never watched this kind of thing.
It's your problem. We're not gonna make it.
We have to make it. Where's Ethan?
George,
long enough.
Yeah, so that's the clip. For people who've not interacted with such stuff, I don't know how you guys feel, but me, when I just watch that thing, maybe there's another clip that's appropriate, but that just comes to mind, and this is what I say. Yeah, so I watch such movies, like it's amazing, but I can't help but what we want to reflect on this week and this month is the mission of Jesus. And when you watch such movies, and I don't know what comes to mind, but I immediately think, you know, there's budget, there's a stunt double, there's video effects. Like, there's a lot that goes on in that moment. The beautiful thing about Jesus and his mission is that when he does what he does, all the resources are within himself. He has everything that is needed for the mission. Our theme will be Isaiah 61:1. We encourage you to memorize it over this month. But it simply says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And this is Jesus saying, and it's saying, he has set me forth. He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to set the captives free, to heal the brokenhearted, and to bring light to those who are in darkness. And that's what we want to explore over the next few weeks. And truly, Jesus' mission is possible. Mission? Him possible. And so I'll let Gishoy let us know how we can give, even as I invite the worship team to give us a number as we give. And then afterwards, we will have our pastor bringing God's word to us.
So yeah, I mean, if you're visiting for the first time, please come on every Sunday. We watch movies in church. And we also sing to each other with memes, as you have seen. So allow us to get to a time of giving. And if you'd like to give, the ways to give are on the screen. Our pay bill number, if you're giving via M-Pesa, is 761777. And the account is tithes and offerings. If you'd like to give towards the move, please indicate using the same pay bill, 761777, the move. And also we can give via bank transfer. The account details are on the screen. Our account name is Nairobi Chapel Lavington. The account number is on your screen. Please go ahead and do that. And also, if you'd like to give via cash, our ushers are coming around. Please feel free to give into the offering basket. And also our guests and visitors who have filled in the card, please put in that card in the offertory basket. Last but not least, if you'd like to give via cards, again, at the info desk, you will be assisted with a PDQ machine and you can give from there. God bless you.
Yeah, bless you. Allow us just to make a word of prayer for the giving and for God's word. Our Father and our God, we bless you and we thank you. We are gathered under your name today to give you glory. Father, one way we are doing it even now is to give part of the resources that you have given us to you, O Lord. Father, we pray that you would bless everyone who's committed to giving to this cause, O Lord. Everyone who's moving in obedience, O God. Everyone who is participating in what you're doing on this earth through their resources. We pray a blessing over them. And Father, we pray even for these resources that you would use them, that they would be a blessing, and Father, that they would be utilized to the expansion of your kingdom, O God. And Father, we pray even as we are ready to receive from you, O Lord, Father, we pray that you'd prepare our hearts, make them ready for what you'll speak to us. And at the same time, we pray for your servant, Pastor Simon Bevy. We ask, O Lord, that you would use him so mightily to proclaim your freedom and liberty to us through your word. We thank you. We bless you. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
nitawapumzisha nira yangu ni laini mzigo wangu ni mwepesi mno jifundishe ni kwangu mimi ni mpole njoni mliovunjika mioyo njoni wenye mioyo mizito nitawaganga nitawaponya nitawapa furaha mimi ni baba wa yatima njoni nyote mnaolia nitawajaza na roho wangu nitawafariji siogope kwa sababu Nitawashika mikono, nitawasaidia. Njoni mliovunjika mioyo, njoni wenye mioyo mizito. Nitawaganga, nitawaponya, nitawapa furaha. Mimi ni baba wa yatima, njoni nyote mnaolia. Nitawajaza na roho wangu, nitawafariji. Tafute njoni kwangu masikini, nitawapa utajiri wangu. Njoni wenye dhambi, nitawaokoa. Njoni mliovunjika mioyo, njoni wenye mioyo mizito.
Wow. Good morning. It feels good. Now I know why people like politics, huh? It just feels good to be escorted like that. Good to see all of you. I've missed you. It's been a while since I was here, and I'm really glad. That was such a powerful song. Don't you want a doctor like her? She's training to be a doctor. Don't you want a doctor operating on you, a singing doctor? That was so powerful. You better graduate soon so that we may come. Anyway, glad to see all of you. Everyone who is graduating from Zindua, I had my team there from Syokimau, so I'm glad to be graduating as well. Thank you very much, Anzaya, and the family for leading us through this. We are excited to see lives changed. Well, I just want to go straight to God's word. There's a lot to say today. And I want to invite you to be bringing your notebooks. Those of you who still write on notebooks, that would be important. I'm going to be saying a lot that you would need to take notes of so that you may revise after. So we're talking about Mission Impossible. And I love those movies. I've watched all of them. And I like action because it reminds me of heaven, huh? And just God's work on earth, that there's a lot of action. That is changing our lives. He's doing stuff every day. There's a reason. This has been such a week, and I want to invite you to continue to pray for this nation so that whatever is happening, God's hand is going to be in it. There's a God in heaven who loves this nation. So continue to pray. Continue to seek after him, especially every Friday. So we're looking at God's mission and our part in it. Things fell apart right in the beginning of the word, right in the beginning of the story. That is in Genesis. And the impact of the fall has affected us right until today. And these are the ways it has affected us, and we could say even more. But self has been affected. You know, after Adam and Eve sinned, they were conscious that they were naked, and they felt ashamed, so they hid. They took some fig leaves and began to cover themselves. They felt bad about self. That's what happened. And until today, we have a broken self. And those of you who are psychologists, you know that a lot of our troubles are right there about our broken self, and we need healing for that. Then, of course, socially, they began to blame each other. There was conflict. By chapter 4 of Genesis, there was death, a brother rising up against another and killing them. Social upheavals, isolation, domination, desire. You know, the curse that came upon the couple was you're going to dominate and you're going to desire. There's going to be an unfulfilled desire. Social issues because of a fallenness. And until today, we have broken relationships. As we are here today, there are many of us who come with broken marriages, broken relationships between us and our children, and many others, even at work. Violence is right there, and this is happening all over the world. I mean, how sad it was to see some of our children shot by the police. And see what we saw yesterday, bodies of people, cut into pieces and thrown into a quarry and being brought out of there. It's very disheartening. It hurts very deeply, especially for those parents. But this began many years ago, right when things fell apart. What about stewardship? You know, man was there and he could eat whatever he wanted. In the Garden of Eden, there were precious stones. There were wealth there. If you read, there was water. There was everything man needed. There was food. But then now he was kicked out because of the fall. So he was out of the garden. The ground was cursed. He had to sweat. And there were thorns and thistles for him to survive. Unemployment began to kick in. He wasn't in a place where he could be supported. And today, with inequalities and poor governance and greed, a few people holding so much, and unemployment of the young people, And I sense this unrest of young people is probably going to be across this continent, because we are the youngest continent on earth. And a lot of young people that are now beginning to look for jobs, and they don't have jobs, and they're asking, what do we do? Why can't you sort us out? And I pray for those in leadership that God will give them grace. I pray every day for those in leadership that God will give them wisdom to know what to do. They need wisdom because it's not easy for them as well. Spiritually, man was separated from God, and we still struggle with sin and business and being away from the Lord. That's still a struggle we have until today. See, what we're doing every day is crying out for help. You know, when our marriages break, we are crying out for help. When our children, go into trouble, into drugs or other things, we are crying out for help. I liked this that I saw online. Budget. Huh? And they're saying unga, 2 kilograms, all of that. And then I was calling for Nja revolution. We need to do something. This is all still a cry for help. Is the next slide. It's a cry for help. People just crying out, we need help. I cry myself every day. I feel there's a desire of what God has in store for me. I'm reaching out for something, but I'm not there yet. So I cry out for help. What is prayer if not a cry for help? That we may get someone to come and save us. And that's why Jesus came. And as before we read the book of Isaiah chapter 61, in fact, I want to invite all of us through this month to read the book of Isaiah. You could read it in a week if you want, but I want to invite you only to read 3 chapters every day. You will learn so much. You know, it's written between the period of 739 to 681 BC for the historians, through Judah's kings, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. And it's like a mini Bible. It's like a mini Bible. It has 66 chapters, just like the Bible has 66 books. And the first 39 chapters, just like the 39 chapters of the Old Testament, is about judgment. And yet, in between that judgment, there are flashes of deliverance. Then the virgin will have a child, and then God will redeem you. There were calls of redemption, and that's what we see throughout the Old Testament. But it was a pointer to the real hope, which is really the New Testament. So the next, from chapter 40 all the way to the end, you'll just see such great hope through the book of Isaiah. Now, it's the most comprehensive picture for me, prophetic picture of Jesus in the Old Testament. We see the announcement of his coming. We see the virgin birth being talked about. We see the mission that he's going to come and accomplish. We see the sacrificial death by which he's going to die, and how he is going to return and claim his own through the book of Isaiah. A theologian has said, John Osort, it's a theological masterpiece that is Isaiah, managing to contain in its 66 chapters virtually the whole of biblical theology. But let me go to Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1 to 3. Let me read these 3 verses that we're going to be looking at before I begin to look at our subject today. The Spirit of a Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. I love this. There's so much imagery and riches here. You know, instead of the ashes of burning or offerings, so that you may find help, there's going to be the beauty of the Lord coming to rescue you. The oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. And that will be called ox of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. take note of a few things here. Number one, that as you read this text, you need to think about Jesus. In Luke chapter 4, verse 16 to 29, Jesus went to the place where he was raised, that is Nazareth, and then he was given a scroll to read, and he found this text, and he read it. And he claimed it. He said, this is my mission. This was about me. He so claimed it that everybody looked at him and wondered, because they had been waiting for the Messiah. Now Jesus is claiming, this is really about me. For it got so bad by the end of a chapter, they wanted to kill him. They took him somewhere. They wanted to throw him off the cliff. But they were marveled at first because of the gracious words, not that, gracious words that came out of his mouth. And then after that, they got annoyed. People don't like grace. And they went and they wanted to throw him away, and then he just walked in their midst. That was like the first miracle Jesus did. People want to kill you. They escort you to the place to throw you down. And then when you get there, you just walk away, and they look for him and they can't see him. They just became blind. I mean, I wish I was there to record that. But it was just exciting to see Jesus. He's saying, this is my mission. This is my mission. This is what I'm going to do. The Jews couldn't take it, so they wanted to get rid of him. And then look at verse 1. It says, this is Jesus saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Jesus, because God the Father. There are a few places in the Bible we see the Trinity together, and this is one of them. So this is not just Jesus' mission, it's really God's mission, because they are one. It's about good news, it's about healing, it's about freedom, it's about the kingdom of God invading the brokenness that has been caused by sin. So today we begin to talk about good news to the poor. I'm so excited about this message. And it's not just for those who are economically poor, as we're going to see, but really exciting to remember the good news that Jesus brought. See, poverty is not just about lack or need, or it's about lack, need, unfulfilled longing, and limitation. It's not just about material lack. Throughout the Old and New Testament, we see a God who is so concerned about the poor. He's always talking about the widows, always talking about the orphans, always talking in Isaiah 58, he says, you guys are fasting and pretending you are seeking after me, but you've forgotten the poor. I like that picture there, because one person is poor, carrying a burden, but another one is also poor, though it looks rich, carrying his own burdens as well. You could be really affluent and be completely poor, as we're going to see. So what's the good news for the poor? That's the question we are asking. Now, before we're going to get into that, because we always think about poverty economically, let me read some facts and figures about Kenya. 16.1% of Kenyans live below $2 a day. How much is that? 260 shillings. That's what they live on. That is according to the Wikipedia. Now, many others, greater percentage, only one, half of a foot away from that place. A lot of Kenyans are only one sickness away from abject poverty. It's really a big problem in our land. Inequality, the wealth gap is such that a tenth of this nation own two-fifths of the total wealth. Only a few people control a lot of wealth. Corruption Perception Index, last year we were ranked 127 out of 180. And we only scored 31 out of 100, 100 being very clean. About 50 of Kenya's population, urban population, they live in slums. But I want to invite all of you. I do this with my family once in a while, and we will do it again before we end this, that you go with your family and just walk around one of the slums. Could be Kibera, one of them. Just go and walk around and see how people live. Maybe sit in one of those kiosks and drink something that is safe, like a soda. And just look around and see what is going on. Or some water. And you will see how people live. You will be moved. You'll be moved. if you're courageous enough, you know, walk into one of the houses there and go and greet them and have a conversation with them, you will see how poverty has a way of taking away the dignity of the people. But you see, again, it's not just about material wealth. Let's look at this story very quickly, Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3, so that we see the levels of poverty and we see how God is inviting us to respond. Acts chapter 3, verse 1 to 10. It's one of my best stories in the book of Acts. Now, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer. Listen, at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, that is 3 o'clock, because Jews, they count time the way we do in our local languages. And in Swahili, saa tisa, ninth hour, which is 3 o'clock. And a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms. He stretched his arms and was begging. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver and gold. But what I do," of course they had some money, you know. They had some money. He was just saying, "I don't have, to give you. It's not in my budget. I have no silver or gold, but what I do, I have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth," where Jesus was raised, where he proclaimed his mission, "rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, jumping up, can you imagine, from being lame from birth, now you jump up. He stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of a temple, asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. And you could read the rest of the story later. But this is a wonderful text. There's so much to mine out of it that time will fail me. But let me start by saying, a beggar at the gate beautiful. Doesn't that sound like a contradiction? Look at this beautiful country of ours. Look at some of the roads we have, and some of the streets, and some of the houses, and mansions, and climate of this nation, yet there are millions of beggars in a beautiful country, begging at a beautiful place. You know, I love this country, but you go to some places and you see the way people live, and you feel moved, and you wonder, how can people be begging in a country that has so much resource? You know, Africa is the wealthiest continent on earth in terms of natural resources, yet has the poorest of the people. Beggars at the gate beautiful. But something else, there are beautiful houses all around here, and some of us live in them, but there are lots of poor people inside of those houses. Being opulent and driving a good German car doesn't necessarily make you rich before God. There are many who are poor. They are lacking a lot. They are still longing for a good marriage, still longing, for good relationships, still longing for peace at heart. And that is a form of poverty. You know, begging at the gate beautiful, a house with a swimming pool. That's what this beggar was doing. So he has no name because he represents all of us. And then two apostles were coming to the time of prayer, that is Peter and John. And then I find it interesting that what their names mean. Peter is a stone, and others say it's a rock. You know, that represents Jesus. And then John means God's grace. Again, it was a proclamation of God's grace that is going to lift up this man from poverty at the gate beautiful. Peter and John together, they're the ones God is using here to lift up this man. Just interesting things there. As you look at this story, then you will see four types of poverty. Are you still with me? All right. Four types of poverty. Number one, self-poverty. Poverty of self. You know, he's a beggar, he's nameless, he has shame. He's always carried there and placed there to depend on others. He has limitations. He has personal challenges. Self. I'm sure maybe he had low self-esteem or other things that made it bedevil a person who from birth, all he does is to be carried. He can't even carry himself or walk himself. He's carried and placed there. Self-poverty, pitying himself, wondering about himself. Don't we have some measure, all have some measure of self-poverty? Feeling less than we should be. Feeling like we are not enough. What about social poverty? He sits there while people are worshiping and others are doing their business out there. He really doesn't have meaningful relationships. He's isolated into his begging. What about stewardship poverty? He's asking for money. Like a lot of people ask politicians, kitu kidogo, give me a handout, kitu kidogo. Now, I think all of you know, at some point, I was running for a political seat. And whenever I went home, everybody would say, si utupatie kitu kidogo, utatuacha tu hivi. You know, are you just leaving us without something small? Everybody stretching their hands. That's what poverty is about. Never having enough. I need more. Give me something, the scarcity versus abundance conversation that Steve Covey talks about. Scarcity, things are limited, so I need a little bit more. Sometimes we see that on the line. The other day I was standing on the line and someone comes from somewhere and just walks in front of me as if I'm not there. And you see, because of growing without enough, we are always fighting for something. You're not even giving someone, nafasi, kuingia, on the traffic. And you're not going anywhere. You know, there's traffic, but you can't allow someone to get in. This is scarcity poverty mentality. Let me grab before the space goes. Stewardship poverty. And it's not only the poor materially who have stewardship poverty. It's also the rich. Were actually possessed by their possessions. Many rich, I'm not talking about you, those who didn't come to church. There are a lot of rich people that are actually possessed by their possessions. And they cannot even have a freedom to give to others. What about spiritual poverty? It was really about the need for God. So Peter and John, grace, God himself, realized this man needs God, not just money. And said, I'll not give you the silver and gold, I'll give you Jesus. Spiritual poverty. See, the good news is that we have the riches of heaven. And the currency of heaven, the riches of heaven, is really two things, grace and mercy. And it's really one, grace, because mercy is a subset of grace. Grace is favor undeserved, unmerited. You get what you would never have gotten because you would never have deserved it. This beggar is sitting there waiting for a little money, but the next step, he is praising and walking around and going to, do his own things. He has gotten more than he asked for. That is grace. Because of brokenness, we deserve punishment. But God gives us grace and forgives our sins. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 to 5 and then 8 to 9. Read this with me. Follow with me as I read. But God was rich in mercy. Out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Someone say amen. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It's a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. Isn't this the good news to the poor? The person who is waiting to be destroyed because of his own sin, the wages of sin is death, to continue to beg all his life because he was lame from birth, he gets a new lease of life. This is grace. John 1:17. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. You know, grace and truth is one word. Came there, in the original language is singular. Because grace and truth are one coin, just two sides of the same coin. And they came through Jesus Christ. All right, let's now look at the text again and compare a few things between law. And law is the gospel that keeps us condemned. Between law and the gospel of grace, which is what Jesus brought, which is the good news. So this man was carried all the time and brought, because he was lame, was brought and made to sit there. But what does grace do to him? Because of grace, he rises up and he walks by the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise God for grace. Lame from birth. Haven't we been defective from birth because of the fallenness and brokenness of sin? Right from birth. But one who has no end and beginning, Jesus himself came. So that in spite of the way we were born and whatever we carried from birth, there is freedom in Christ Jesus. You don't have to be condemned to whatever you were born with. You know, he was sitting there in condemnation just to borrow until he breathes his last. But now he has been healed because of the grace of God and is standing in freedom. He was covered by the shame of being a beggar. But now he has been released and he goes into the temple and he's running around praising God. In fact, when you look a little later, you will see the people who are there looked and say, isn't this a guy who had been begging there? Now he's running around. And they were marveled. And in fact, Peter had to stand up and say, men of Israel, listen to me. Let me explain. Why are you looking at us as if by our own power we have made this man walk? No, it's not about us. And he said, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, your fathers, they longed for Jesus for this day of grace. He says the prophets, Samuel. Then he talks about Moses as well. Moses prophesied that are greater than he. Greater than the law, grace will come. This is what is happening. This is what Peter was saying. It's not about the Old Testament and the covenant there. It couldn't do this. It's a new covenant we have in Christ Jesus. This is the good news. Covered with shame, but now praising in victory. Begging for survival, a little money, but now has been released. Covered with glory. Covered with glory. You know, the most of the people passed there, they were impersonal to this man. They would throw some money and move on. But look at what Peter and John, the grace of God, what they do. What do? They come close and they say, look at us. There's a personal God who through grace knows you personally. Knows you personally. You're not just a statistic. He has your name. He knows your name. So they come down and they look at him and say, look at us. It's not about the money. It's about something more that you need. This is a good news. That we're not statistics of cosmos, explosions. No, we're people that God knows very personally. Look a little bit more at that text. You know, the beggar draws pity. But the man now stands up, walking around because he has been healed, brings wonder to the people and say, Allah, what has happened? They begin to wonder because of the miracles of God. And I want to say to all of you that I believe God is doing something in your life that the closest of your friends are going to wonder and say, isn't she the person that we knew? What has happened to her? What has happened to him? God has changed things. Grace makes all things new. I know I'm not done. And I love Anzindua. You know, in our team, we kept talking about the window is closing. The window is closing, but for grace. Even when the window has closed, there's a God in heaven who is going to do wonderful things. So I prophesy to all of you, because of the grace of God, even in your 60s or 70s, there's a God who will make you a wonder before your friends. Grace will lift you up. He was looking for a handout, and I hope the politicians can hear. Kenyans don't need handouts. They need a hand up to be able to do something. When you give 50 bob and 20 bob, that is, abuse to the people. But when you help them to stand up so that they may go and find a job and do things for themselves, you have helped them for a long time. There's a God in heaven who is reaching out by grace to each and every one of you to lift you up. You know, it's interesting, this happened at 3 o'clock, ninth hour, during the time of prayer. Isn't it interesting that in Genesis chapter 3, it was in the cool of the day, 3 o'clock onwards, in the cool of the day, that God came to find the man has run away because he has fallen and call him, Adam, where are you? Isn't this also the time at the cross Jesus cried, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? And he was crying at around 3 o'clock, saying, I am crying with humanity. Oh God, have mercy on us. Let the grace come. And of course, God heard, and here we are. You know, this man was begging, seeking for money. Give me something little. But then he found Jesus, who is greater than money. And the Bible says, when we don't worship God, we end up worshiping money. Over-identifying with money and thinking money is riches, but grace is. The man was weak and struggling like many of us in our sins and weaknesses, but he was strengthened by God's grace and he was able to stand. I pray today by God's grace, every struggling person among us will be lifted up and strengthened. May we overcome the sins in our own lives, the challenges in our own lives. But then let me say this as I come to a close. Do not frustrate the good news. It's very easy. With the good news of grace, with the good news that you are set free, that God has come to lift you up. You don't have to beg for a few things here and there. You have him. You have the fullness of God. We sometimes frustrate the good news by resisting God. Insisting we want to be independent and do it our own way and dull our conscience and continue to walk in sin. We're cheapening the grace of God. We frustrate good news by feeling that we are undeserving. I'm just a lady. I'm just a man. I'm just, I don't have what it takes. I'm not pretty enough. You know, beating ourselves because we are lacking acceptance or we are lacking affection or we are lacking appreciation. May the Lord lift us up from that place. What about isolating ourselves, not sharing grace with other people? Not being part of a family. This is why I love church and this church. As we did Zindua together, we were building family. We were receiving riches, the riches of relationships, social riches, and abandoning poverty. And sometimes we hinder those relationships because we have not forgiven. We have not let free someone who has hurt us. So we remain in social poverty. What about greed? When we are so greedy, we want more. The more you have, the more you want. And the possessions possess you. What about those poor who don't have anything? Would there be a way that we will lift them up? Later in the month, we're going to be talking about some ways to lift up the economically poor. So begin to think about some of the ways you can be a blessing. You see, my friends, the law that came by Moses was about condemnation, was about human strength. These are the 10 commandments you need to follow, and you will be right. But grace came to convict us of sin, but also give us the forgiveness. The Spirit strengthens us. The grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness Titus chapter 2. So it's really about the love of God. You know, why are so many people living in the prisons of poverty all over the world when Almighty God Himself came with a message of grace and said, you don't have to stay in those prison cells of self-poverty, of social poverty, of stewardship poverty or economic poverty, or even of spiritual poverty. Jesus said, I'm here. Receive me. So what is the application of our message today? Two things. Let's embrace the grace of God. Let's embrace the grace of God, the riches of heaven in the four areas of our lives. I believe there are some of us here, God is calling to forgive, to let go, to reconcile. Some of us, God is calling us to release ourselves from the struggle of sin and realize God has forgiven us and He's reaching out to lift us up from that place of sin. Let's embrace the grace of the Lord. But then number two, let's minister to the poor among us. Those in our neighborhoods, those near us who are maybe socially poor and they are lonely. There are those who are materially poor. There are those who are, you know, those areas of poverty. What if we did what Peter and John did? We stopped long enough to look at them. And then we listened to their story and appreciated their story. And then we gave them a hand and lifted them up from wherever they are. The grace, the good news of grace. See, nobody is going to go to hell because of their sin, because Jesus already died for sin. There's grace. You don't have to allow sin to take you to hell. No, people go to hell for rejecting the grace of God, for rejecting love already provided, for rejecting what is freely given. That's how we take ourselves to hell. We keep ourselves in hell by refusing the grace of God that embraces us and says, you're beautifully and wonderfully made. You belong. You're a child of God. Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, we are grateful for the gospel of grace. If it were not for that gospel, where would I be? I wouldn't even be here preaching your word. I would be lost completely and condemned because of my mistakes. Thank you for the grace that forgives me. Thank you for the grace that restores me to good relationships. Thank you for the grace. We celebrate the good news today. I just felt as I prayed this morning, as I close with a prayer, that the two categories of people that God would love to minister to, those of us who have been in a bad place of self-poverty, beating yourself, feeling like you don't deserve, just feeling useless, feeling condemned, feeling like you're just condemned to your situation, whatever that situation is, but you have issues of self, maybe rejection, maybe feeling less than enough, whatever it is, if that's you, I want to ask you to raise your hand. And then lastly, I want to pray for those of us who are in a place of stewardship poverty. You don't have a job or you don't have provision and you're really at a bad place and you're saying, God, would you come through for me and help me out? If you're in any of those two categories, please raise your hand. I want to pray with you. Thank you. Thank you for those hands. Let me add, allow me to add, if you've never known the Lord as your personal Savior, and you want to say, even me, I want to give my life to Christ. I want to receive a grace. Or maybe I was a Christian and I backslid. I went into living wrong. And I want to say yes to the grace of God that forgives me. Would you raise your hand together with those who have raised their hands? Thank you. Thank you. Almighty God, we're grateful because grace knocked the prison doors down. We're grateful because a mission that looked impossible, that human beings could be forever be released from the condemnation of the fallenness of humanity, that you came and you opened the doors and you taught us to walk free out of the prison. Thank you for each and every one of us. May the message we have heard today begin to break the chains that hold us back in those four areas of poverty. Lord, I pray for those who raise their hand, those who need forgiveness of sin and need to receive that forgiveness by the grace of God, for by grace we are saved, not of our own works. There are those who have been in a place of poverty of self. Those who have been felt rejected, felt not good enough. I pray today that you will release them out of that prison cell. Release them, Heavenly Father, that they will not be condemned to their identity that they have held on to, but they will know who they are in Christ Jesus, sons of God, products of grace. I pray, Lord, for those who have been in sin and are saying, I release it right now, that the grace of God will teach them, according to Titus 2, to say no to all ungodliness and every temptation. I pray for those who don't have a job and don't know what to eat or are struggling with paying rent. May the Lord of heaven, the God of grace, visit them today. May you show them some friends who will help them out, so that they may find help in this time of trouble. So, Lord, I pray in a generation that insists on the law, on paying for our own sins, of feeling God is punishing us, I pray that our generation, our eyes would be open and we will see the good news of grace. May the sound of grace be all over this place, all over our nation, from politician to the poor in the slum. May the grace of the Lord come upon all of us as we receive Jesus. Would we together say the grace now? And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the love of God, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Would we celebrate God for the grace? For the grace. For the grace. Looking forward to Sunday, and we're going to spend time on Sunday to pray for those who are unwell. And we are believing God for some miracles of healing as well. So may the Lord bless us as we go into the week. As we hang around, please congratulate the Zindua people as you see them around you. And those of you who want to sign up for the next cohort, please go ahead and sign up. May the Lord bless you. Greet your neighbor and say, the grace of God be with you. Have a good week.